We're live? We're good?
We're live.
All right, let's rock and roll. So yesterday we decided that we were going to push our current scheduled YouTube episode that was going to go out today. And instead, my assistant and my wife had a great idea, which was, let's just answer questions live on my way down to a listing appointment down in Newport Beach, because we opened the Altman Brothers office. So right now, for the next 15 minutes, I'm yours. I think I got 110,000 views on that video. And so I got a lot of questions to answer in a little amount of time. So you guys ready to rock and roll? Let's do it. So I got Sweeney in the car driving. And say what's up, Sweeney.
Yo, yo, what's going on?
And I got my legendary brother behind you, Matt Altman. I got Matt behind you answering the questions, and he's filming. So hopefully it's not too shaky, but let's rock. First question.
All right, Josh. First question comes from Lori Keats 72. How has the COVID-19 pandemic affected the real estate business, and how are you adjusting and or coping with the changes that it's brought?
All right, great question. Thank you for that. How's COVID affecting the business? When COVID hit about 6-7 weeks ago, it hit the Altman Brothers hard, no question about it. Anybody who says differently in real estate sales is lying to you. We had about $100 million in escrow at the time, and we lost about 70 of that $100 million due to the virus. We ended up closing out the remaining 30 since. And since then, we've seen an uptick of about 25% in the market. And so, you know, at this point, after we had to adjust and find out how we're going to continue closing deals in our backyard, on our house phones, on Zoom, not face-to-face, we then have recovered, which is great. It's still an uphill battle. But really, over the past 10 days, we've seen a lot of real estate start to happen, a lot of showings start to happen. Masks, gloves, that's how we're doing showings now. I even did 2 deals, which this is crazy. In my entire career up to this point in real estate sales, which is almost a decade, I had sold 2 houses, I think, without ever showing the houses to somebody. They had bought sight unseen. In the past 2 weeks, I've opened escrow on 2 houses sight unseen. Is that the norm? I don't think so, but we're definitely gonna see it more often. One of them was a New Yorker who wanted to get out of New York City. He wanted the lifestyle in LA due to this whole thing. He had a change of heart and a change of what he wanted in his life. And so he ended up buying a house by the beach, sight unseen. So it's pretty wild. It's gonna be an uphill battle. No questions about it. And we're gonna constantly be adjusting. It's like a moving target, figuring out what works and what doesn't work. But the only way that you can figure that out is to go through the motions and actually do it. So that's what we're doing right now at the Altman Brothers. And we're recovering and we're getting back to where we were. And hopefully bigger than ever. You gotta realize, in a market like this, a lot of sellers have to sell. And a lot of buyers want to buy, that's for sure. All right, next question.
This is from Right to Irene. How did you and Heather meet, and who made the first move?
Who made the first move? Heather made the first move. Come on, I was playing hard to get. I negotiate for a living. How did we meet? We actually met on the show. I mean, that was all real, as everything on our show is. I met her at Josh Flagg's open house in the Beverly Hills post office area. It was a modern house. I remember everything about it. First time I met her, laid my eyes on her, is all on camera and all made the cut.
All right, from Reza78, love the show. Important facts to know before buying a home. What are they, and where are the best places to live in LA, in your opinion?
Best places to buy in LA. Well, look, there's different pockets that are hot, and it depends how much money and what your budget is as far as what you want to spend. I like a lot of different up-and-coming areas, but I also like some of the trophy areas. In markets like this, I always talk about spending a little more to make sure that you get the prime location, and I'll tell you why. I was in 2008, where I had lost everything. I lost everything that I had built up to that point when the economy collapsed. And because of that, I realized that the properties that took the least of a hit where the property is in prime locations. So they're as pandemic proof, economy proof as you possibly could be, as far as real estate is all about the location. So I always say pay a little more for the prime location. The things you need to know, I mean, look, in this environment, you got to make sure you got a great title person. You got to check the title, make sure there's nothing on title that's going to be an issue for you in the future. Also, look, spend a lot of time at the house. You know, some people are okay with just seeing a house once or twice before buying. I personally like to spend many, many hours at a new house that I'm trying to buy. I like to see it first thing in the morning, in the afternoon, late at night. I like to drive by it a dozen different times. I like to drive the neighborhood. I like to get a feel for it. I talk to the neighbors. So that's what I typically like to do to make sure I'm making a good investment.
All right, next question is by Inspired by KC. Josh Alman, how are you and Josh Flagg's friendship / bromance lately? Have you ever even talked to Madison or see him around anymore?
Okay, well, I get that question a lot. I haven't spoken to Madison. I was blocked on Madison's Instagram probably a year and a half, 2 years ago, maybe even 4 years ago, I don't even know. But I haven't spoken to him at all, so there's zero relationship there. And as far as Josh Flagg, I think we have a love-hate relationship. We're not really hanging out outside of real estate, but you know, I think we respect each other's different sales techniques. However, I feel that mine is a lot more effective. But look, he's a nice guy. He's wacky as hell. That's all I gotta say about that.
Allison Carroll, she asked about your relationship with your assistant. It seems it's pretty wacky and fun. How is your relationships with the people you work with?
Well, I like to have fun with a lot of people that I work with because it's a very high-pressured environment that we do work in at the Alman Brothers. Lots of yelling, lots of high pressure, time-sensitive stuff going out all the time. So when we're not in that environment, I like to have fun with my assistants. I like to have fun with my agents. I hang out with all my agents. I hang out with my assistants. And we really try to keep it a nice family light environment until it gets down to business. Then everybody knows fun is over, business starts, and we do it like that. And then we can snap back in and out of those, which is good. So, yeah.
They're asking, where is your LA Rams helmet? You got to support your friend.
So yeah, one of my best friends, Sean McVay, big shout out to Sean, love you brother. So I am a Rams fan because I live in LA and we like to support Sean. Obviously I got Patriots blood going through me because I'm a Boston born and raised guy. We ran into that little issue at the Super Bowl of the Patriots and the Rams, so I had to decide at that point. But I do support the Rams when they're not playing the Patriots. Now, another question that I got was, am I now going to be a Tampa Buck fan? And, well, because Brady went there and Gronk went there, I will tell you this. I'm excited to watch the Buccaneers this year. I will tune in. I will watch them. I will root for them after I root for the Patriots and the Rams. So now I got all these teams. I've never had that before. I don't know what to do. But yeah, that's my answer to that question. Patriots all the way, baby.
Can you give any advice to investing? This guy's talking about investing in the stock market and a lot of his money has gone down. Where do you see investing in the future and where would you put your money?
Well, look, I'm heavily invested in real estate. I like to invest in what I know, in what I use, in what I see, breathe, touch. Always from day one, I've been a lot more invested in real estate than the stock market. Obviously, I have a lot of clients that are heavily invested in the stock market. I think right now, as far as investing, a lot of people are buying a lot of different things in the stock market. But I think it's gonna be a little long term. I think if it was me, I would pull the money out of the stock market and I'd get super aggressive investing in real estate. I think there's going to be a lot of deals out there this year. I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity to take a step up in the category of whatever financial category you're in times like this, in times of crises. This is when people, if they make the right move, take their wealth and their net worth up to another level. So for me, for instance, let's say, would I rather have $500,000 in the stock market or $500,000 in the real estate market? I would take that $500K because that's what I know best and invest it in real estate.
I think that's important though. It's loving what you do and knowing what you do. So if you're in art, now's a great time to buy the right art pieces. It's capitalizing on what you know. You know, I was made that brilliant investment last year on Bitcoin and lost every single penny of it. And I learned that I want to invest in real estate, you know?
That's it. So, you know, just do what you know best. I personally like to touch and feel and see my investment, and you can do that with real estate. You know, we know God's not making any more land, that's for sure. So that's what I like.
AZ Guy, 1911, do you remember the very first house that you sold? How much was it? Tell us about it.
Yeah, of course. I remember everything about it. The first house I sold was on a street on Rising Glen in Los Angeles in the Hollywood Hills. It was a $1.6 million piece of, a teardown, but a piece of land, basically. And that same piece of land today is worth, with the brand new 10,000 square foot house on it, is worth about $18 to $20 million. So I will never forget that deal because I needed that money from that commission more than I needed air at the time. I was as flat broke as possible after coming out of that 2008 when the economy obviously collapsed. So I was broke, and that's when I started again. Those of you who read my book, It's Your Move, you know, I was a millionaire by the age of 26, and I was flat broke by the age of 26 and a half.
Oh yeah.
There it is.
What do you typically bring with you to your real estate listings?
I'm actually on the way to a listing appointment right now, and I am bringing I'm rocking my sneakers because we're going down to Newport. So, you know, got to play it a little cool. What you see is what you get. No listing packages. When we go into our listings, we like to have a lot of really quality face-to-face conversation. And I don't need a book to sit in front of me to talk about us, who we are, what we do, and why we're the best in the world. But I like to look in the seller's eyes and have that conversation and be engaged. And that's what we take. We used to, obviously, and if you're watching this and you're not, you know, where you think you need to be yet to do that, don't. Show up with an amazing listing package. I've seen some of the best, and they're really good and they're really effective. But you got to figure out what works for you. Okay, that's the most important. Are you the type of person who needs to, you know, look at something and go off of it? And are you the type of person who just likes to kind of, you know, schmooze and do it that way? So for us today, we roll in, we have fun, we like to have fun with it. And obviously, you can't have a lot of fun with it until you get to a certain point in your career. But when you do, listen, it's fun. We got the greatest job in the world. We're real estate agents. I love what I do, and it's, you know, it's contagious, and the sellers see that. So I don't need to bring a book with me.
All right, we're getting a little personal here. How has the quarantine affected your marriage since it began?
That's a great question. And I think that's a very realistic, normal question to answer right now for those of you watching this who are married or living with your significant other. During this quarantine, it's tough. Man, is it tough. I'm not gonna lie. I've never spent this much time at home, ever, either with my wife or with my kids. So the good news is, yeah, this is quality time that I'm never gonna be able to do again with my kids that is so special to be part of. Now, the reality part of it is, man, is it difficult to be locked up with your family, especially with babies. My wife and I have had our share of arguments and fights over the past 6 weeks. It has not been all flowers and butterflies. There's been a lot of tug of war. There's been a lot of giving in order to take on other parts of the relationship. I feel that our schedule, that we came up with a schedule because we were butting heads. And I'm sure a lot of you watching this were like, you know, it's like, I'm not a babysitter because I'm used to being in the office hustling, but those roles changed a little bit, and I became a babysitter very quickly. And my wife is trying to juggle closing deals and obviously taking care of the kids. So we switch off, and we actually made schedules that were...
Was it called Closing Deals, Making Meals?
I like that. Closing Deals and Making Meals. That's a good one.
What is that red shark gun on the shelf behind you? I like whatever it is from Brook 421.
Oh, you like that? So, that was an artist named Chris Schultz, who I'm still really good friends with. That was a piece that he made, and I love it. And I've had that for a long time. That went from my desk in the office to my desk in my home office.
Do you know that shirt that you cut up, what did you do with those arms? You could make those into masks.
I did. I made, so every shirt I cut up is an extra mask that I have that I wear when I go out. I actually now at this point have about 12 different masks. I like to accessorize my mask. My babies has masks with like little Elmos on them. And I like to have fun with it. But everybody who knows me knows I like my cut off sleeveless shirts because I like to feel free, because sometimes I'm in those tight suits and I can't move all day. And so when I get home, I'm like, ugh.
I think the last question would be, who is better between you and your brother, and why isn't he on the show more?
That's a good question. So Matt actually did not want to be on the show when they were casting. And that's the reason why I went in and took the lead with that. We felt that we needed one of us to really concentrate on the business and one of us to obviously concentrate on the business, but also be available for filming. You don't realize how long and how much time of a commitment filming is for Million Dollar Listing. It's 10 months a year, multiple times a week, and it's extremely difficult to carry your business and also be on this show. So I've been blessed to have a brother who has also carried the business. And now, because our business is a well-oiled machine, we're able to have Matt on the show more. We have fun filming on all different avenues, from YouTube to the show to Instagram to all that stuff. So we have fun with it now, but that was the initial reason. Matt was an extremely successful talent agent before he got into the business. And so he has a really good background dealing with high net worth clients. And so we've used that obviously to build the business as well. And he's been an amazing partner. I love him. Some days I hate him, but it's super, it's probably the greatest thing in the world to be able to work with your family member, your brother, somebody you love. I get the best of both worlds. I get to work with my wife and my brother. And I don't know how many people can say that, and some people will say, oh my God, that's crazy, but it's the greatest gift that I've ever gotten. So I attribute that to the success, because it's a true family business.
Yeah, that's why we treat everybody like family that works with us.
That's right.
And last question, I guess, is just from me. Are those mini awards all over your shirt? What exactly are those?
So check this out. So these are all the real estate records that we've broken. We've gotten different awards, and each one is a different one.
That's it.
So,
15.
Anyways, I love you guys. Thank you for listening. We are about 20 minutes outside of Newport now, and
game time.
Game time, baby. Got to get into the game time mentality, which we still do today.
Let's go.
And that's it. So thanks for joining, and tune in, subscribe. I love you guys.
Steven Schwede.
Nope.